Good evening to one and all present here for the Xavier Center of Historical Research, Istria. I'm Malcolm Barreto, the administrator of XCHR, and I will be your webmaster for today. A few instructions for today's Istria. The first point being, when the Istria begins, kindly turn off your mics and cameras for better quality transmission of the Zoom meeting. The second point is, please put your questions, queries, clarifications, and comments in the chat box only. Please do not use your microphones and camera to ask questions or clarifications. Professor Shaila D'Souza will convey all your questions and clarifications to the speaker, which is Professor Sushila. The third point is, please avoid derogatory remarks and comments in the chat box. And I want to bring this to your notice, that this Istria is being recorded, which will be further posted on our YouTube channel. I now hand over to the Director of Xavier Center of Historical Research, Father Anthony da Silva, to welcome the speaker, chairperson, and the August gathering. Over to you, Father Tony.
Good evening to all of you. We are very delighted that the XCHR platform can host Dr. Sushila Mendes and her message. And we are also grateful to Dr. Shaila for chairing this session. We have a tradition, as you know well, at Xavier Center of digging into our history, our historical past, and sharing that research with the community of people who live around us, as well as with a community of scholars from universities and colleges. And so we are very happy that Dr. Sushila Mendes has chosen a topic that is not often addressed in the history of this little state of Goa. And this is about the female voice, and the female voice in the course of many centuries. So it is of great fascination and interest for all of us today in the 21st century. With these few words of welcome and delight, I hope you have a good evening and you enjoy the session. And we have this tradition of having history hours at least once every month. And please feel very welcome to join the Xavier Center community whenever we offer you these kinds of delights. Thank you very much and have a pleasant evening with us.
I now welcome Professor Shaila D'Souza, the chairperson of the day, to introduce our speaker, Professor Sushila Savant Mendes. Over to you, Professor Shaila.
A very good evening to all who are logged in to this online session of the History Hour. It's my pleasure to chair this evening's session on resonance of the female voice, womanism, and the church in Portuguese Goa. Our speaker today is a scholar of Indo-Portuguese history, Professor Sushila Savant Mendes. Professor Sushila has been a history teacher for 31 years at the Government College of Arts, Science and Commerce, KEPE in South Goa, and was recently the recipient of a long overdue Goa State Teachers Award for Excellence in Higher Education for the year 2020-2021. Professor Sushila Mendes has authored a book on Luís de Menezes Braganza, Nationalism, Secularism, and Free Thought in Portuguese Goa, and has also several research publications to her credit. I'm sure all of us are looking forward to hearing Professor Sushila's views on how the church and the Portuguese administration gave impetus to women's voice and a more empowered status. According to our speaker today, she has relied on archival sources such as historical archives of Goa, records maintained in the church archives, and also interviews and other secondary sources. Without eating into the time for our esteemed speaker, I request Father Malcolm Barreto to kindly share with the audience a few suggestions that would enable the smooth conduct of this session. Over to you, Father Malcolm.
Thank you, ma'am. I'd just like to repeat those points again. When Professor Sushila starts the history hour, please turn off your mics and cameras for better quality or transmission of the Zoom meeting. Secondly, put in your questions, please, your queries, clarifications, and comments in the chat box only. I repeat, only in the chat box. So please do not use your mic and camera to ask questions or clarifications. As I said earlier, Professor Sheila, when the Q&A session begins, she will address your questions and clarifications to Professor Sushila. I would also recommend to avoid derogatory comments and remarks in the chat box. And kindly note once again, for those who have come in just now, this history hour is being recorded, which will be posted on our YouTube channel. I now cordially welcome ma'am to take over. Over to you, ma'am Sushila.
Reverend Father Tony, Administrator of Xavier Center, Father Malcolm, Coordinator of this program, Professor Sheila D'Souza, Chairperson, ladies and gentlemen, and my dear students. I thank the Xavier Center of Historical Research for this opportunity. In fact, the Jesuits have been very patronizing to me right from my St. Xavier's days in Bombay to recognizing every milestone in my academic journey, be it my first history hour after being awarded my doctoral degree, to my second history hour today after being awarded professorship in history. A humble thank you. Thank you also, Professor Sheila D'Souza, for chairing this session. My topic today is Resonance of the Female Voice, Womanism and the Church in Portuguese Goa. I have used the word womanism as different from the word feminism, as womanism is essentially a concept used in Asia and Africa and deals with the right of the woman to live or to exist. Feminism, on the other hand, is essentially a Western concept which deals with many other rights, like the right to make choices and many other freedoms. The word female used in the title is deliberately used instead of feminine, as my subject deals with gender rather than the qualities attributed to this gender. The term Portuguese Goa is, of course, with reference to a colonized Goa. To place this topic in its relevant context, it is important to first understand the background, in brief, of the narrative of Goa's history. Goa was ruled by the Portuguese for over 450 years, from 1510 to 19 December 1961. The map of Goa changed down the ages, and even the Portuguese captured different parts of Goa in different time frames. The old conquests, or the areas that were conquered first, were Bardez, Salcet, and Ilhéus. The new conquests, these were the territories annexed in the 17th. Later on, you have the old conquests, the territories annexed in the 17th century, and later, like Ponda, Kepeng, Kankon, Pedne, Bisholi, Sange, and Satari, where there is much less Catholic influence as compared to the very dominant position of the church and Christians in the old conquest. Within this historical context, we must understand that the Goan women are no less different from their counterparts in the rest of the country. The media, of course, portrays a different picture of Goan women, of Goa in particular, of sun, frolic, and fun-filled Goa, with sea and beaches, and where women are sometimes more Western in their dress habits and are less conservative than the women in the rest of the country. There is a popular perception that in the rest of India, that wine, women, and song are easily available in Goa. This viewpoint is even depicted in a caricature by Goa's famous cartoonist, Mario Miranda, titled Observers from the North, Oogling a Girl in a Bikini on a Goan Beach. In Goa today, we have our own share of women's collectives and non-governmental organizations fighting that for a women's voice be heard. As a student activist, a group of us were founder members of a women's collective named Bailanso Sar. Bailanso Ekot is another NGO which protects the rights of women in Goa. This paper is based on archival sources from the archives of the Bishop's Palace or the church archives and the historical archives of Goa. It is also based on oral history and a few secondary sources, one of which is the work of a Catholic nun, Sister Emma Maria Apostolic Carmel, and other books on the social history of Goa, wherein women form an intrinsic part of the social narrative. For greater clarity, this paper is divided into three parts. First, a brief background or a brief discussion on pre-Portuguese Goa. The second is the colonial space of the Portuguese period. And the third are the concluding remarks on the post-colonial period. In pre-Portuguese Goa, the female voice was stifled with the then existing social norms of what was essentially a non-Christian or a Hindu-Muslim society, as Catholicism was largely introduced in Goa by the Portuguese. Child marriage, polygamy, dowry, sati, patni dharma, enforcement of strict widowhood, complete economic dependence on the male, added with other systemic denials like ownership of property, divorce, and widow remarriage. The life of a woman was confined to the four walls of her hut and home. This was the Hindu and the Muslim period of the Bojas, Chalukyas, Shilharas, Adil Shah of Bijapur. The map of Goa, of course, changed boundaries during the rule of these different dynasties. The higher castes among the Hindus, as well as the Muslims, had more restrictions on the very movement of women as compared to the lower castes or classes. This is a universal observation of the medieval period across India, as in the case of Rajput and Mughal women. Goa was no different. The powerful system of patriarchy had taken firm roots in the Goan society due to the influence of religions that legitimized and sanctioned gender discrimination and subjugation. D.D. Kosambi, in his study of pre-Portuguese history of Goa, examines how tribal worship was reflected in the occasional gifts offered to the tribal chiefs. He further adds that with the coming of Aryanization, local cults were assimilated and temples were constructed dedicated to the Hindu gods as well as goddesses like Betar, Deonsar, Bhumika, Satteri, Shantadurga, etc. The petroglyphs of the mother goddess in Uzgalimal and Kurdi in Goa and the female goddesses, idols found in the rest of Goa show the existence of the worship of goddesses in the pre-Portuguese period. Coming to the Portuguese colonial period from 1510 onwards, it introduced conversions, both voluntary or as a result of incentives and sometimes also forced, and thus began the process of Lusitanization. The long history of Portuguese colonialism only further deepened the roots of patriarchy in the social and ecclesiastical setup. This was a complex process which cannot be reduced to simplistic arguments of contemporary political debate. And yet the fact remains that in this instance, religion was used as a supportive arm of the Portuguese Empire. It is my argument that during the colonial period, the Portuguese administration and the church in particular were the handmaid of the state, and both together did much to strengthen the tone and tenor of the female voice. The Portuguese came to India in search of spices for the King of Portugal and souls for the King of Heaven. Their policy was that the religion of the king would be the religion of the people, and therefore the vigorous policies of evangelization began. Various religious orders and congregations came to Goa. To facilitate this process, the first to come were the Franciscans in 1517, mainly in Bardesh. The next were the Jesuits in 1542, the Dominicans in 1548, and the Augustinians, who came and tried to convert Triswadi. The dominant order in Salsette and in the islands of Chorão and Divar were the Jesuits. Later, an order with Goan natives came into being called the Oratorians. The missionaries had less knowledge of Hinduism, its principles of the Trinity, transmigration of the soul, the caste system, and other factors. And therefore, the work of conversion was more difficult here. Goa is interesting as a part of the subcontinent that experienced a different history because of the tiny area and a small population. It is a history in a hothouse, as it is, as it were, all the hotter because of the white hot zeal of the early conquest and the determined resistance by those who felt the heat. These are the words of Paul Axelrod in his work on the flight of the deities. Hindu resistance to Portuguese Goa is a part of his subject. The solution to this was what they impressed upon the civil authorities to pass laws against the religious practices of the converts. The religious orders sometimes were more powerful than the civil counterparts, especially the Jesuits and the Franciscans. Robert Newman, the well-known anthropologist, discusses how the Portuguese brought religious intolerance and forced conversions followed by the Inquisition. Hindu temples were destroyed and churches or chapels were built on the same sites. I have published a source from the archives of the Biblioteca of the Palacio da Ajuda in Lisbon, wherein the people of AVC petitioned to the King of Portugal to protest against the burning of their pagoda at Fatorpa in 1728. Female goddesses were also worshipped in Goa. The goddess of Kunkoli, a village in Fatorpa, near Fatorpa in South Goa, is Shanta Durga, a form of the classical Hindu goddess Durga, also known as Mahamaya or Mamai in Goa, and linked in myth to Kali, Parvati, and the bloodthirsty Matrakas Durga, which is a warrior goddess, not linked or subordinate to any male god. She has been associated with blood sacrifice, meat eating, and fertility. She is seen as sometimes forcing male gods to surrender their powers to her. Shanta Durga means peaceful Durga. Shanta Durga is a mixture of northern Durga and southern or indigenous Santeri in Kunkoli. There is a shifting of dual identities, both based on the female goddess. A person can be at the same time a good practicing Catholic of the Virgin Mary and also a devotee of the village patron goddess Shanta Durga. The Virgin Mary is identified in the popular mind as similar as Mamai Saibin, even if separate. The Foral of 1526 was an important decree called Charter of the Usages and Customs, Foral dos Usos e Costumes, prepared by Afonso Mexia, the general superintendent of the budget. An attempt was made to codify the existing customs with a view to evolve a comprehensive administrative machinery with which it would be easy to govern the islands of Goa. Albuquerque did not interfere with the working of the Gaonkaria or the village communities or comunidad. This charter sanctioned and legalized the social system of the Goan Hindus, for which they had to pay taxes in return. The inheritance procedures and rights were also fixed. The woman had a right termed Patni Bhaga, or the property that was divided into as many parts as the number of wives. Bigamy was banned among the Christians. The charter did not permit a daughter to have a share in the inheritance of her father's property. In the absence of a male child, the property of the deceased was taken over by the king. Christianity was the state religion in Portuguese Goa. It maintained status quo as far as the Hindu woman was concerned. To attract more women towards Christianity, a law was passed on 22nd March 1559, stating that the wife and daughters of a man who had died without a male child could be entitled to his property, provided they accepted Christianity, failing which the property would go to the king. The next of the kin would also be the heir to the said property, provided the person accepted Christianity. On July 27, 1559, another law was passed that the daughters who embraced Christianity would gain inheritance from their parents in case they had no brothers, and in such a case, the other relatives had no share. Albuquerque prohibited the custom of sati in 1510. However, the law passed by a colonial government could not do much to change the mindset of the local people. Viceroy Constantino Braganza tried to put an end to this practice on June 30th, 1560. Sati was prohibited by the constant requests of the church provincial councils of 1575 and 1585 to the King of Portugal. Legislations like alvaras, portarias, and edicts, and promulgations or resolutions of the above church provincial councils denounced sati, and also passed decrees permitting young widows to marry again if they wish to. A decree was issued to ban sati in Barde, Salset, and the islands of Goa. The penalty was the forfeiture of property of the guilty person who was sentenced to life imprisonment. 50% of the forfeited property went to the church, and the remaining half went to the person who provided the information. On June 27 of the same year, Viceroy Francisco de Tavora legalized widow remarriage, and it was finally approved when the king passed the law on March 17, 1687. Governor Pestana issued an order to abolish sati in December 1884 in the old Congress. It was common for a widow to be badly treated in the household by her relatives and made to work like servants. Sometimes they were even sexually exploited. Sati and polygamy were prohibited, and converted women could now inherit property. A widow had no share in the resources of the family and was not permitted to remarry in Hinduism. On the other hand, a man could marry two or three times. Unlike the Hindus, the Christian woman could also freely remarry, develop their talents, own property, as well as servants and slaves. Harsh laws were promulgated to prohibit this practice, with severe punishments of confiscation of property and enslavement for life of the person forcing directly or by agents like relatives to commit sati. Half of this confiscated property would go to the informer and the other half to the church. This was the benevolence of the Portuguese in passing a law prohibiting sati. This was the objective of the law, and the church in putting down a pagan practice. Perhaps Albuquerque must have abolished sati with the aim of saving the widows for his men. The very church which helped in the prohibition of sati and promoted widow remarriage did not hesitate to torture, burn, or skin alive those new converts, including women, who in the eyes of the Inquisition did not follow the principles of the Catholic religion. It must be understood that once legislation is passed by the state, especially in partnership with the church, it continues for posterity unless it is abrogated by it or by the post-colonial government that succeeds it as ultra vires of the existing laws in force. The position and the status of a woman does not change overnight with successive governments, whether foreign or local. The progressive Portuguese civil code is a heritage that has been passed on and is still in practice in Goa today. However, the code itself has negative as well as positive provisions with regard to the position of women. It does allow women to inherit property irrespective of the religion, and the civil registration of marriage is mandatory in Goa. A second notice is issued by the civil registrar of the couple's intention to marry before the general public. The church also announces three times, known as bans, or three on three consecutive Sundays to the congregation to come forward and inform if for any reason the marriage should not take place. Many a times, laws are subverted by just crossing the border to Maharashtra or Karnataka, where the uniform civil code is not practiced. The family laws also permit divorce, but only Hindus are allowed to adopt. But in the case of divorce for Christians, permission of the church is mandatory. With the introduction of Catholicism, free movement of women in society was introduced, like dancing for social functions, unlike their Hindu and Muslim counterparts. Elite women moved in palanquins and were educated at home. Helpless women, like orphans, divorced women, deserted women, wives, and unwed mothers, took refuge in charitable institutions of the church, like the House of Mercy or the Santa Casa de Misericordia. This holy house even brought slaves to work for it. B.S. Shastri has made an in-depth analysis in his article on Church and Women in Portuguese Goa, A Social View. He argues that in a male-dominated world, the weaker sex had to take more often refuge in God by means of worship, prayer, going to church, fasting, etc., or sometimes even join the religious orders or work in charitable institutions organized by the church and the state. These were the Santa Casa de Misericordia, or the Holy House of Mercy, the Senado de Câmara, or Senado de Goa, the Municipal Council of Goa, the Confrarias, or the Confraternities, Pai dos Cristãos, Father of Christians, the Orfas del Rei, Orphans of the King, and Obras Pais, Pious Works. Financial assistance was provided by the church to needy widows, deserted wives, orphans, female converts who were abandoned by their relatives, and arrangements were also made to provide employment to some of the more educated women. However, though these institutions were discriminatory in accepting members and in rendering help, they did transgress boundaries of race, color, religion, and gender. In the absence of other institutions to assist the orphans, female slaves, widows, these institutions of mercy provided immense service. The Holy House of Mercy of Goa was begun on the basis of the Lisbon counterpart, Afonso de Albuquerque bequeathed his property to this house so that it be utilized to provide dowries for young girls. The work also involved accommodating these girls in decent households until they were married. So orphans were given dowries to find suitable men, and many a times government posts were given to the men who married them instead of dowries. Finding suitors for orphan girls seemed to be more important to the society of that period of the 16th and 17th centuries in Goa than helping these young girls to stand on their own feet. This house provided asylum to slaves, both female and male, who were ill-treated and thrown out by their masters. The system of slavery that existed in the whole world also stimulated Lusitanian passions, and prostitution of female slaves became common. Due to different causes, the death ratio among European men was considerably higher than among the Asian and African women. As a result, most Portuguese colonies had the difficult task of looking after widows and orphans who had to live their lives dependent on charity. So this House of Mercy was in charge of two other charitable institutions, the Home of Our Lady of the Mountain for orphans and the Home of Saint Maria the Magdalena for women who had gone astray, like unwed mothers, prostitutes, and widows. The Royal Convent of Santa Monica was a monastery for nuns. However, there was discrimination among the European novitiates and the local Goan women, both in terms of the dowry that they brought with them and the color of the dress that they wore. All this in a place where the women entered to lead a life of piety and seclusion. The Goan nuns had to pay 5,000 sheriffins and the white European nuns paid 3,000. Those who wore the white veils were the non-Europeans and those who wore the black veils were the madres or the mothers and were always European. The institution of the casados was the first organized institution that affected the status of women, started by the first viceroy, Afonso de Albuquerque, wherein local Muslim Goan women married Portuguese fidalgos. So local women were the first Lusitanian citizens of the empire. These men were given a whole lot of incentives, such as plots of land, houses, and encouraged to learn skills required in the Portuguese colonies. Women were thus used to create and sustain the Portuguese empire and Christendom. Very few Portuguese women came all the way to Goa, but the more important aim was to ensure a local progeny that would remain loyal to the Portuguese administration. With this in mind, Albuquerque introduced a policy of miscegenation. The Portuguese therefore took the women of the land and Lusitanized them to serve their colonial interests. Hence, the Portuguese developed a concept of womanhood, which they added to the colonial designs of the Christian notion of women. Goan women were helpless, as in the early years of foreign rule, they were converted and married irrespective of their will in the face of slavery or sometimes death. Initially, the widows of the Muslim soldiers who were killed in the fighting with the Portuguese were taken as wives for the Portuguese. Eventually, the Hindu ladies were sometimes forced to be the brides for the Portuguese men. The Goan women preferred getting converted and married to the Portuguese men, as they could then lead a peaceful life, own property, and be treated with respect. To the criticism of Portuguese officials that it was not safe to trust the overseas settlements in the hands of the casados and their progeny, Albuquerque justified himself, stating that he got the Portuguese to marry who were fair, pure, modest, and simple in their ways of living, and not women of Malabar, as they were dark-complexioned and of doubtful character. Prestigious posts were assigned to them, like inspectors of the markets, judges, mayors, aldermen, etc. With the inclusion of local women into the Portuguese colonial world through marriage, the strength of the Portuguese colonies increased, and thereby the demographic factors supporting the colonial plans for the crown. The first provincial council did not want the non-Christians to practice polygamy and recommended that the king pass severe laws against those who did not practice monogamy. Efforts were made to find out the reasons for polygamy, and it was found that in several cases, the first wife had physical disability problems and she was disliked. In some cases, she was accused of infidelity, or in still other cases, because no son was born of the first wife. The said council did not permit, or rather banned, Christian women from obtaining assistance from a Hindu midwife or a dai or even a wet nurse at the time of the delivery. The reason was that no Hindu rituals would be performed by the dai. The church, however, prescribed what women should do or not do, what they should wear or not wear. The Portuguese Inquisition, which began in 1560 and lasted for more than 200 years, forbade the use of certain traditional clothes within the precincts of the church. Earlier on 8 July 1644, an episcopal decree had ordered that the newly converted Christian women not to wear a nose stud or a nose ring. In the book, Goa Rare Portraits, by Wendell Rodericks, it is written that the Portuguese Inquisition forbade the display of a naked midriff in church, the episcopal order of 14th April 1736. So the owl was used to cover their entire bodies by the Catholic women so as to satisfy the Portuguese diktats. Converted women could not wear fresh flowers in their hair. The reason given for this by a Catholic priest whom I interviewed was to subvert another of the Hindu religious practice, which is still in practice in the temples of Goa, that of using flower petals, by which the Hindus used to invoke blessings from their temple deities before starting a business venture or even take the decision of a marriage, in the form of an oracle performed by the temple priests, wherein the deity answers are determined by the falling of flower petals from the idol. Correspondingly, the newly converted women would use their saliva to stick flower petals from their hair to the Catholic idols of the saints in the churches as a continuation of a cultural practice that they had been used to over the generations and could not stop abruptly because of a change in religion. A lot of the elite women made gold jewelry representing local flowers to adorn their hair instead of fresh flowers. Customs and traditions became a part of life, and like water finds its way through rocks, people also found innovative ways to register their disapproval in the approved manner as per the law. The same edict of 1736 stopped the festivity of the first menstruation of a married girl. There could be no feasts or celebrations and no exchange of presents, as was done in the Hindu community. The said edict also banned the ceremony of the Soti or the Shashti Pujan, wherein the Hindus would remain awake on the sixth night of the birth of the child and celebrate with banquets so as to drive the evil spirit away, as per the prevalent superstition. Among the Goans in the early period, we find that There were many other superstitions during the early part of the Portuguese rule, like the belief that the child of a woman who had died in childbirth would one day destroy its father and relatives, just as it had its mother, and therefore the father was advised to kill it. Silva Rego cites an example of a man who was actually going to choke the child and throw it into the river when a young Jesuit priest intervened and saved the young life. The same edict prohibited to sing on the occasion of marriages, and the use of Hindu musical instruments was banned. It also banned the newly converted Christian women from wearing the choli. Also, Christian women could not participate in any religious procession dressed like the Hindu women using tilak or kukum on the forehead. The edict prohibited the plastering of walls with cow dung during or after the confinement of the women, as it was a Hindu custom. It also ordered that within a period of 2 months after the delivery, the mother should not wash herself near any well, or also not keep betel nuts or areca nuts or any edible thing. This perhaps was to protect the mother from any infection, as the immunity levels of a mother who had just given birth to a child are relatively low, and they can easily become victims of any outside infection. The Catholic widow lived a much more humane existence than the Borki. The Alvara of June 27, 1684 allowed widows to remarry irrespective of the caste to which she belonged. A Jesuit writing around 1560 affirms that the Hindu wives, since the time they were forbidden to burn themselves alive with their husbands, adopted the custom of renouncing all colored dress and going about with their head shaved. The practice of the Borki was unfortunately a cruel custom that was practiced behind closed doors. Not only was the head of the widow shaved and she was not permitted to wear ornaments or colorful clothes, but she was even forbidden from putting on the tilak on her forehead. Even food with ingredients like garlic and onion were forbidden, with the belief that they would ignite sexual passion in the woman. She could also not remarry or inherit the family property. Her social movements were restricted. Thus, in keeping with the local norms, the Hindu widow had to live a life of gloom and despair. It was like a life of abstinence from all pleasure. Only fasting and prayer were permitted. With no income of her own, it was the life of a virtual slave. The bolder women among these could easily be enticed to embrace Christianity. The Third Provincial Council of 1585, these are the provincial councils of the church of the period, discussed the inheritance rights of a daughter, wife, and the widow. The council found fault with the husband or relatives who declined to provide for the Christian wife. The law of June 15, 1557 empowered Hindu wives, daughters, and widows to demand their entire inheritance from their parents and grandparents upon conversion to Christianity, failing which the property would go to the crown. A law dated December 1567 granted Hindu women who had converted to Christianity the right to moiety or of her husband's estate. The Alvara of June 1644 also had a punishment to the parents or close relatives who forbade a widow from remarrying by confiscating her property. Christian widows had the opportunity to wear colored clothes, cosmetics of their liking, and enjoy themselves instead of leading a life of misery. They would also inherit property as per the Christian law and even marry men of their own choice. There was a scramble, however, in the early years of Christianization to convert Hindu widows As once converted, the church, symbolized by the Catholic missionaries, secured a share in the widow's property. Remarriage was therefore encouraged. The Alvara passed by Viceroy Con the Alvor on June 27, 1684, made it mandatory for the women to learn Portuguese within 3 months, failing which they would be severely punished. This was a necessary qualification for the Christian women to get married. Decrees were passed by which the church directly regulated a woman's life. The Provincial Council of 1567, Decree number 12, regulated that non-Christians within the jurisdiction should be permitted to keep, should not be permitted to keep a mistress. As a result of this decree, temple girls or the bailaderias were deprived of their benefactors. The same decree did not permit a convert to marry a second time while the first wife was alive. Violators of this order were punishable with enslavement by the king at his pleasure. An episcopal rule of 28 May 1604 required that the newly married couple should not cohabit during the wife's pregnancy, unlike the Hindu practice of that period, where the woman was taken to the maternal house. The same decree ordered that a Hindu widow below the age of 40 years could remarry after a period of 1 year or choose to remain a celibate, or she had to live in the house of a Portuguese national or a good native Christian. This was to prevent young widows from following the traditional custom of not remarrying. Remarriage was condemned by parents and relatives who regarded it as a dishonor, virtually condemning a second marriage. Many episcopal decrees were passed because of the customs of child marriage and arranged marriage. Archbishop Santa Catarina from 1784 to 1812 condemned the practice of getting 12-year-old girls married before they were capable of evaluating the duties of a marriage. One decree ruled that the bride's face should not be veiled and her responses at the marriage ceremony should be audible. Goan Hindus retained many Hindu customs, so the church authorities decreed several measures to modify or abolish them. Thus, it was decreed that the bridal couple had to declare under oath before the parish priest that they knew each other and were happy with the marriage. The parish priest was required by the episcopal edict of April 27, 1780 to uncover the face of the bride and not follow the Hindu rite of washing the feet of a father, washing the feet of the daughter and son-in-law on the day of the wedding. This ensured that the bride be identified and could answer all the customary questions clearly. The priest who failed to fulfill this requirement was liable to be suspended. The policies of the church did amount to infusing the Goan society some elements of modernity, where nationalism, humanism, liberalism, and secularism were important principles of life, irrespective of whether the church actually intended or not. Positive stance like the prohibition of sati, the right of the women to inherit and own property, permitting widow remarriage, did help in improving the socio-economic position of women even after the Portuguese left Goa, as the Portuguese Civil Code continues to be in force in Goa even today. It was therefore the influence of the church that made the Catholic women more independent and prosperous as compared to their Hindu or Muslim counterpart. The Hindu women did not have much opportunity to socialize except for the temple fairs, weddings, rituals, and ceremonies. Christian girls could get married after puberty, unlike the child marriages practiced among the Hindu girls. Wedding among Christians is even today celebrated with pomp and festivity, notwithstanding a law dated 20th August 1596 and a government alvara dated 1st February 1681 and October 1792, governing expenditure on weddings. Female education on a mass scale was relatively unknown. Srinivasan Sheela discusses three reasons for this. Number one, the Hindu texts advocated the dependency of women throughout their lives. The practice of parda also restricted the movement of women. Secondly, the girls' education was ended after the primary stage. Thirdly, it was considered a disgrace to a reputed woman to learn to read or even acknowledge the same. These are the views of Sheela Srinivasan. This lack of education kept the Goan women subjugated in the pre-Portuguese and the early centuries of the Portuguese rule. The only education required or considered essential was the necessity to learn the household duties. In Goa, only the dancing girls were said to have received a formal education. Girls were not sent to school, but were generally instructed at home. Later in 1606, they were educated at the Royal Convent of Santa Monica and that of Santa Maria Magdalena. Factors like child marriages, which resulted in early motherhood, parda system, and the various superstitions resulted in the fact that female education in Goa was neglected during the pre-Portuguese and the early Portuguese period. In fact, with the coming of the Portuguese, one would have expected liberal changes. However, the new colonial masters did not do much to provide facilities for the education of both Hindu and native Christian women. The Alvara of 1684 of Conde Alvor recommended that girls be taught to read and write in convents or by private tutors at home. Menezes Braganza, in his thesis on education in Portuguese Goa, reiterates that not much was done for the cause of women's education in Goa. The first primary school, or the Escola Primaria, for girls saw the light of the day in 1846 in Panjim, and 8 years later, two more schools for women were open in Margao and Mapsa. In post-colonial Goa, the church encourages small Christian communities as well as youth groups in each parish. Also, the Society of St. Vincent de Paul, a charitable organization of the church, and the Legion of Mary gently make their entry into the domains of family and community service. To conclude, today we have a church comprising of local Goans, unlike in the colonial Portuguese period. The Portuguese are also replaced with a popularly elected government by the people of Goa. Post-colonial politics, however, has taken a different turn. And today, the church and the government, unlike the colonial period, are often at loggerheads with each other. The church in Goa has a department which has under its purview a social justice program. It supports or backs so-called people's programs, like in the recent past, environmental issues like the mining and the coal transportation issue, against the need to build a double track in the hinterland villages of Goa, and the destruction of forest land in the name of development, like that of building highways and the installation of high tension wires. In present times, therefore, the church is with the people. The church is a very powerful influencing agency, whether in the Portuguese period or in the post-colonial period, in changing the patriarchal mindset of society. A participatory church supposes a differentiation and mutuality of roles. The church needs to be more vocal about shared parenting as against stereotyping gender roles, taking head on social and cultural norms that even challenge the existing law of the land. For example, women's right to equal inheritance of parental property. Our Goan society still resents this, though the law permits it. Protecting women from abusive husbands and even abusive children. My argument is that while the colonial church did take strong stance and pass decrees to ban social evils, much more is expected of the church of today. The church has the expertise, the respect, and even blind obedience of its flock. Three very important parameters for reform of society in general and of women in particular. Thank you for your patient listening.
Professor Mendes, I will open the session up for questions. As Father Malcolm has suggested, we type the questions in the chat box. I don't see any questions yet, so I will wait for a little while till we start getting questions, or maybe if we, you know, if Father Malcolm will permit, we can have some people come in and ask questions.
I think, ma'am,
yes,
we shall wait for some time in the chat box. What would happen is that too many people would be asking a lot of questions. So we shall wait the chat box. Then you decide what is best.
Sure.
But we shall stand to it.
Sure.
The questions be
I will wait. I will wait. But in the meantime, while people are writing, thank you, Sushila, for the, you know, the wide canvas of things that you've presented today in the span of 45 minutes. I have my head spinning because there were lots of ideas that you've thrown up, you know, from pre-Portuguese to the colonial period to post-colonial. And maybe while others are writing their questions, you know, you talked about how you know, benefits to women came with conversion. So my question to you is, did everyone, all women, benefit during the colonial period, or was it, you know, would that be considered womanism if there are certain women who were left out because they didn't convert? And also during the Portuguese period, when there were, which you talked about, you know, bans on dyes and midwives practice, there were women, there were Goan women as well. My thinking would be their livelihoods would have been affected with these kind of bans. How do you put this in the discussion of womanism?
Can I reply, Professor Shaila?
Yeah, sure, please. Yes. I was just waiting for people to write, so yes, write in their questions, so I asked you.
Sure.
Go ahead.
With the coming of Christianity,
the religion changed, but the cultural practices, the social practices are very difficult to change with a change of religion. Culture sometimes goes beyond religion. Wearing of flowers in the hair and calling a dai at childbirth. These are essentially cultural and traditions that were followed in Goa over the years. So though the women changed their religion, it is difficult to assume that they embraced the Christian cultural practices immediately. And I would also like to say that it was not, the changes did not take place in all classes of women. We have the local, the ethnic groups in Goa, the Kunbis, Velits, Dangars, where this hardly mattered. Even the Christian converts in the Kunbi community, the Adivasis, did not benefit from these changes because their culture was different. And till today, the whole 400 years of Portuguese rule, some of these communities were never even allowed to enter the primary schools. So that generation of the tribal communities were never educated. It is this generation that with education has embraced progressive ideals. So womanism was very positively seen among the higher classes, the higher castes, and ignored with regard to the lower sections of society who were making ends meet under the Bhadkar Shahi, under the land tenural system that existed at that time.
Thank you, Sushila. There's a question from Frederick Narona. He says, just a query, is it fair to compare the 16th century practices with the 18th? It is also said elsewhere that the British used arguments like critiquing salt to justify, their role in building a colonial India. Even today, the issue of women's rights is often used as a justification by dominant groups of male to justify their own societies being more just than others. Your thoughts, please.
A beautiful question, thank you. When we discuss the topic of the role of the church with regard to womanism, I cross different centuries that the colonial government ruled in Goa. I have not separated the centuries per se. I have separated the laws per se chronologically as they took place, passed by the provincial councils of the church from the early 16th century to the 17th century and thereafter. So definitely it is not proper to compare and contrast the centuries, because each century is considered to be more progressive than the previous century. But we are talking about a colonial government. We are not talking about a free society. The church at that point of time was definitely the handmaid of the state. So the church provincial councils, the government, the governor generals, in fact, the Archbishop of Goa sometimes was the governor general in the absence of the governor general. So this is a different society that we are talking about. Did I miss out
another question in the same question? Or have I answered?
I think we'll move to the next question.
Yes.
A question by Eldrin D'Souza. Eldrin D'Souza says, can you comment the status of women in Goa under Portuguese rule than the women under the British rule in the rest of India? Just wanted to know your view, as it looks like women during the Portuguese rule were in a better place than in colonial India.
Thank you, Eldrin. Your submission is the same as mine. The British were, of course, of a different sect of Christianity, and as compared to the Portuguese, the Portuguese church was a progressive one in Goa, as compared to its counterpart in the rest of the country. Because, unlike the Portuguese, the British never encouraged so many rights. There were no parliamentarians in the British Parliament, unlike the Goans, who had a right to talk in the, as deputy in the Portuguese Parliament. The women, I must say, in the rest of the country were not a homogeneous group, unlike Goa. In Goa, there were Hindus, there were Muslims, and then came the Christians. But in the rest of the country, it was definitely different. So women in each state of India had different cultural practices, different spaces. Okay, one really cannot compare the two, but yes, the position of women in Portuguese Goa was more progressive, and perhaps that's the reason why even today the rest of India looks upon Goan women as from being so westernized and so different from themselves physically when they come into Goa. So there is a definite line of distinction between British India and Portuguese Goa, for sure.
On the lines of this Western image, I think it follows with Charlotte's question, who were the ones who were persecuted the most, the Catholics or the Hindus? She means converts. Was it only merely to protect religious sentiments or also some other ulterior motives? I guess her question is about conversion. So did really conversion not persecute, were Catholics or Hindus? Her question is, who do you feel was more persecuted, the Catholics or Hindus?
From what I have said in my paper, the Hindus followed a separate sect of rules and laws, which the Foral accepted, which the Foral protected those Hindu women of usages and customs of the local people way back in the early 16th century. The new converts, the women and the men who converted to Christianity, followed a separate set of rules and regulations. And therefore, the two communities had allegiance to two different set of beliefs. I would say that there was an opportunity for the converted Christians to stop practices that were inhuman, like sati, like child marriage, like
being deprived of their parental property of the Bodhki. India practices which the conversion changed completely. But it is not right to say who was more persecuted, because here it becomes, persecution from your point of view, but acceptance from another societal point of view. If the Hindu women accepted their religion and their practices, it doesn't become persecution for them. So it's an outsider's point of view that you are stating, that are the Catholic women less persecuted? So it's a point of view, it's a perspective, who was more or less persecuted from an outside point of view. From the inside, each community is loyal to its own beliefs and customs and rules and regulations.
I mean, in your own words, Dr. Mendes, you talked about inquisition. So I'm guessing that conversion did come with its fair amount of persecution. We'll move to the next question by Maria Fatima Pais. It says, it's one thing for women to have equal rights for men with men on paper, especially in areas of education and inheritance. However, in reality, who enforces or ensures that women get that is rightfully their share?
Absolutely. This is what I said to conclude, that there are legal provisions in the Portuguese Civil Code which ensure the rights of women. But there are societal pressures, there are cultural pressures which deny these very rights to Goan women, especially among the Goan Catholic women. The right to inheritance, for one. A girl is looked upon as greedy if she asks for her parental share. This is so across religions, whether it's the Hindu religion or Catholic religion in Goa. We have so many examples of women asserting their rights once, in the legal field. Once the brothers need to sell the property, they need the signature of the woman. And so long as the usufruct is enjoyed by the brother, it doesn't matter. And if you compare the dowry and whatever gold, etc., is given, it is sometimes less than 1/10 of what is actually the value in terms of property. So I perfectly agree that, laws are one thing, but social norms, social pressures are quite another. I have so many progressive friends where the mothers are very clear that this is for my son. And I have told my daughters whatever I have to tell them. So irrespective of the law, social pressures create big pressure in families, even to accept legal law, to accept laws which protect you.
Thank you, Sushila. I got a reminder that we're overstepping the time, but there are just two questions which I'm going to club together, because Reina has logged in, as well as Eltron has asked a similar question. So basically, it's about comparison, between the status of women in the Portuguese era and today. And that was Eltron's question. And Reina says that, do you see any difference between the status of women who had converted to Catholicism and the Hindus, the women, the status of Hindu women?
I would like to club these answers because my study deals with how the church in colonial Goa protected or did not protect, whatever, womanism. My study actually is not about a comparative study of the women today, though I have concluded with post-colonial role of the church that it plays today. Though it is outside the scope of this study, which is the answers to these questions are more sociological than historical, I would like to believe that yes, there is a definite difference between the status of women of the colonial period and the present day period, because the present day women with education, with independence of thought and ideas, with the backing of institutions, are definitely in a more progressive space than their counterparts in the colonial period. Today you have fathers backing their daughters, you have in educational institutions, the teachers backing women, you know, never treating anybody differently. And young girls blossom in this very positive environment. Of course, there are situations where this is not reaching out to every single community in Goa today. That, of course, needs to be corrected. But education is a great game changer. And therefore, this has helped in making women think for herself and decide for herself today.
Thank you, Dr. Sushila. And thank you all for this interactive session. There have been many more comments. I know the session is being recorded, so Dr. Sushila will definitely have access to all the comments and suggestions. And I'd like to say, as a women's studies person, that you know, women have been the sites of focus of, you know, social reform. They have been targets of conversion, the bans. They have been the, you know, the targets largely because of their you know, the how they've seen as being pivoting a role, their pivoting role in social practice. But we need to look at this whole, you know, role in a, you know, of the Portuguese rule in Goa, cross castes and classes. And I think we get a much more holistic picture of, you know, what the impacts have been. And looking at some of what the baggage that we have today, and the baggage that we're carrying today, we need to reflect on that as well. But thank you very much, Dr. Sushila, for throwing light on several, you know, dimensions. And thank you to this wonderful audience. Have a good evening and see you the next History Hour.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, I would like to speak on behalf of the Xavier Center of Historical Research and the director, Father Anthony da Silva. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our speaker for the day, Professor Sushila Samuth Mendes, who is a professor at the Government College of Commerce, Arts and Science in Kepe, for being very resourceful on your topic, the resonance of the female voice, womanism and the church in Portuguese Goa. Thank you very much for your facts and views on the contribution towards women in Portuguese Goa. Also, thank you also for the view that we as men of the church, how to reintrospect in terms of, you know, giving women their rights and liberties. Thank you very much. I would also like to thank Professor Shaila D'Souza, the Dean of Manohar Parrikar School of Law, Governance and Public Policy, Goa University, for chairing the session and managing well the Q&A session. Thank you very much, Professor Shaila D'Souza. Lastly, I would like to thank you, the audience. You have been very cooperative. And at the same time, thank you for your active listening. And it is because of your active listening that we were able to have this history a grand success. So thank you very much and have a nice day. So good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, one and all.